Hey everyone, my name is Jen Lammers and I'm a correspondent at Extra, where I'm currently on set in Burbank, California. I moved to Los Angeles a little more than a year ago from a city I will forever call my home, New York. I've been a longtime supporter of Answer the Call and have served as honorary co-chair of the Red, White, and Blue Soiree. I so wish that all of us could be in the same space right about now, but sadly, like so many other things, this virus has taken that away from us too. One thing that hasn't changed is the dedication of this organization to help as many families as it can, especially now. We've lost so many of our first responders to COVID-19, police officers, firefighters, EMTs, our frontline heroes. They answered the call when it was unsafe for us to even leave our own homes. Tyena Scalf lost her husband, Detective Jeffrey Scalf, to COVID-19, and I'm honored to help share their story.
We met in, well, I was in high school. We met end of my junior year, June of 93. He had come up from North Carolina. He was in the Marine Corps. Yeah. And a friend of mine was dating a Marine, and he brought his buddy up to, you know, come to New York for the first time. We hit it off right away. Been together ever since. We got married in 1995. Wow. On Veterans Day. This year, 11/11 would have been our 25th anniversary. Oh my goodness. Yeah, we were talking about renewing our vows. but yeah, we have three great kids. We have a son, our oldest, Alex. He's 24. Yeah. And we have Maria, 21. And then our little surprise baby, Charlie, who's 6.
So how did you know that he was the one?
You know, it's funny because we were so young and people like, oh my God, you're crazy. It'll never last. I knew it would. I knew how great he was. I knew he was amazing. I knew he'd always take care of me and the family. I just knew.
24 years married, you know, you shared an entire life together. You raised three beautiful children together and then he got sick. Tell me about, was that in April?
Yeah. He passed away April 13th. He went into the hospital. It was the night of April 4th, so really April 5th. It was, you know, after midnight. He had come home from work Thursday, seemed fine, and he was going to eat dinner and just started shaking all of a sudden. And I was like, are you okay? He goes, I can't eat. And he had a fever. I took his temperature. It was about 102 or 103, just out of nowhere. He felt fine before that. A little cough here and there, though. And then, you know, we locked it down. It was tough finding a place to get a test. Mm-hmm. One of, you know, the officers, his bosses, got him in to take a test the next morning. Yeah. And but it was too late. That next Saturday is when he went into the hospital.
Wait, so he got sick. He had a fever. And within about a week, you said, it was when he went to the hospital?
A couple of days. Yeah. So he, you know, the whole next day he was like quarantining in the house, you know, staying in his room. But he was walking around, he was talking, you know, and I've seen him sicker, been with the guy 27 years altogether, you know, I've seen him with the flu. I've seen him, you know, and he kept saying he was fine. He could breathe. He kept saying, no, I can breathe fine. It's just, I get bouts when I cough. It hurts when I cough.
Yeah.
And he was malaise, a little tired. He was upstairs. I went upstairs later on that night to give him his medicine, you know, Tylenol and all that stuff. And I couldn't really rouse him. I couldn't really wake him up. Mm-hmm. And I thought he was just really tired. And my son is a paramedic. So I called him. Yeah, he was working and he was trying to talk to him on the phone. And he goes, Mom, we need to call an ambulance. Something's wrong. And sure enough, when the ambulance got here, his oxygen was at 53%.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, which was crazy because an hour before that he was talking. It literally just boom hit him. So he was in you know, acute respiratory distress. They got into the hospital and you know, he was intubated, like everybody was intubated when COVID first came out. And they really did the best they could. I can't say enough. I know they tried. I actually used to work at the hospital. So many friends of mine, you know, were working on him and, you know, they were giving him messages from us because I couldn't see him. Nobody could see him. So that was, he was there for about a week by himself.
To have someone taken from you that unexpectedly Where did that leave you and your kids?
In a complete fog and a daze. Tuesday was 6 months, and it gets worse, not better. Yeah. It gets a lot worse. Surprisingly, when you think it can't get worse, it does. You know, like birthdays and things like that. Those are tough times. You know, I got the phone call from Answer the Call, and I didn't expect it. And I was like, what? Wait, who are you? You know, they're telling me, you know, they're going to give us this and they're going to help us with this. And I was like, wait a second, what? Because I wasn't even thinking about anything like that.
Okay. You're still going through it. I mean,
yeah.
The last thing you're thinking about is like, is someone going to help me? You're just trying to like survive at that point.
Yeah. I mean, I just wasn't even thinking, but then it's like, holy crap, like that's real. Like yeah. Bills are an unfortunate, you know, part of life. And, you know, it was just very, very humbling when they called because I didn't know why. Like, how'd you get my name? Like, I didn't understand. I didn't know anything about them before this.
Yeah.
So I just thought it was amazing. I think that it's great that people, you know, pull money out of their pockets, their hard-earned money, and they willingly give it.
I just wanted to thank you so much for sharing your story. My heart is with you and my heart is with your family. And I know the Answer the Call is going to be there for you. NYP is going to be there for you guys. And
for sure.
I give you all my hugs and all my love, Tyana. Mm-hmm.